Now, the relentless cut to the fire and rescue service in the fire brigade union view now mean that we are way past crisis point. We believe that we've got a fire and rescue service that is now not fit for purpose. Now, the fire and rescue service, as you know, plays a fundamental role in our communities, tackling the day-to-day risks that we all face and we all potentially face. And the role of a firefighter has constantly evolved from that of our predecessors. In the time that I've been in the fire service, my job is now completely different from the job it was when I first joined. And fighting fires does remain a core duty for us, but it doesn't end there. Firefighters respond to road traffic collisions, industrial disasters and rescues, chemical spills, major incidents such as terrorist attacks and civil disturbances. And during the riots in 2010, our firefighter control room staff handled over 5,500 calls in 3 days. Now, we also play an irreplaceable role in emergency response to the 7/7 terrorist attacks and also responded to the recent terrorist attacks in London and beyond. We're the primary responders to flooding as well. Nearly 75% of boat rescue teams in England are fire service teams. And as the storms wreaked havoc across the nation in 2015, firefighters were on the front line protecting people, property and communities. Firefighters from this brigade were going to other regions to protect the public of those regions. And we responded to over 1,400 flooding incidents in this region alone. And last year, we rescued 40,000 people. Of them, only 10% were from fire-related incidents. We are simply indispensable for the safety of the public. Now, downward trends, and this is what the government will tell you, downward trends in fires and fire deaths are being used to justify these savage cuts. Now, forgive my bad pun here at the moment, but that's just simply smoke and mirrors. From a government that's intent on dismantling your fire and rescue service and has been actively vandalising your fire and rescue service since 2010. Now, the improvements in reducing fires are down to our members. They're down to the hard work that our members put in each and every day, going out into their communities, giving fire safety advice and carrying out home fire safety risk assessments and checks and giving you that advice. So if you cut firefighter numbers, you cut that advice, so fires start to go up and we start to see an increase in fire deaths again, which is what we're seeing. Now, nationally, firefighters each year carry out over 1 million safety checks in people's homes. Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service, though, has been hit disproportionately with the cuts. We saw a previous 52% cut to our revenue support grants. Now, firefighter numbers have been cut during the last 20 years, but as I said, that's nothing compared to what's happened since 2010 and what's forecast up until 2020. As during that period, firefighter numbers have reduced from 927 to 580. And as has been said by previous speakers, fire engines have been cut from 42 to 22. And that means that despite decades of decline in fire deaths, we're now seeing overall in Merseyside from 2010 to 2016 an increase in fire deaths, a trebling in fire deaths from 2010 to 2016, 5 fire deaths in 2010-11, up to 16 fire deaths in 2015-16. So our view as the Fire Brigade Union that the statistics for deaths is on an increase. Now, fire stations have been closed or earmarked for closure as well. West Kirby, Allerton, Whiston, Highton, Eccleston and Upton, with other stations already or proposed to be downgraded. And the downgrading simply means that the closing of a night time. So for 12 hours of a night, fire stations will be closed, with firefighters then on pagers turning in from home, expected to be there within 30 minutes. Now, Crosby, Aintree and Kensington have already had this downgrading imposed, with Wallasey and City Centre due to follow shortly. And fire engines, due to the firefighter cuts, now are crewed with 4 firefighters as opposed to the much safer crewing of 5 firefighters. So that means that we're limited now on what we can do when we attend fires with 4 riders. All of this means that by 2020, only 13 fire stations will remain crewed by whole-time firefighters. Now, to put that into perspective, when I joined 30 years ago as an operational firefighter, and I'm still operational firefighter, when I joined 30 years ago, there was 26 whole-time stations. So that number by 2020 will have been halved to 13 whole-time stations. And the majority of those fire stations now only have one fire engine in them, where a lot of them used to have two. And the closures and downgrading of stations and the axing of fire engines and axing of firefighters results in increased attendance times, as fire engines now have to travel from further afield. It's blindingly obvious, isn't it? If you have stations closed, only one fire engine, if those are fire engines from a particular area, are at a house fire, they're now putting fire engines having to travel from much further afield into those areas to deal with the fires. And this occurs quite frequently. Increased attendance times also mean the fires develop more by the time we get there. So that means that's a greater risk to the public and a greater risk to the firefighters who are then committing into those fires into a more developed fire. We also now, as firefighters, face the most awful dilemma when we arrive at fires, because we're arriving at fires with only a crew of four, a lot of the time with just one fire engine while we're waiting for the second fire engine to attend. Now, if we face people trapped upstairs and there's a developed fire downstairs, our policies and procedures direct that we can't split up, as we've only got a team of two firefighters and breathing apparatus, so we're presented with a choice. Do you fight the fire or do you go and rescue people upstairs? Now, let me be quite clear. Firefighters will always put the public safety first, and we will break policy and procedure to go and rescue people, putting our own lives in danger, because if there's no one tackling the fire downstairs and there's a flashover, a backdraft, or it develops, we're trapped upstairs and we'll potentially die with the residents of those houses upstairs. And if we do, there's a potential that we'll be disciplined because we broke procedures and policy. And if we are and we're dismissed from the service, if something goes wrong, the financial security of our families is thrown into doubt. Now, firefighters aren't stupid people. We recognise that these cuts are coming from central government, and we recognise the disgraceful position that the fire authority and the councils on the authority have put in. And I'm 100% certain that the fire authority recognise the dangers of the cuts that are being imposed on them. And firefighters over the last 8 years have actively sought to assist the fire authority in mitigating against the worst of the cuts. And in that period, firefighters have voluntarily changed our historic and much loved duty shift system to one that we dislike, to give a 12-hour day to produce 3 more hours productivity during the day. We've changed our work routines to increase the amount of community work we undertake, to continue to put our communities first, to make sure that crucial fire safety and the fire safety checks is done. We've reduced the duration of previously agreed breaks. We've taken a voluntary pay cut from the nationally agreed rate of pay to provide increased financial resource for the fire authority to keep fire engines available. And we've agreed changes to long established practices to keep specialist appliances, such as the high reach hydraulic platform ladders. You've seen them, they're the ones that go up to a huge height, up to under a foot, to get people out of high rises. We've changed our policies and procedures locally, and the FBU have agreed that we'll do that. We'll change our procedures to allow those to be continually crewed, because we recognise how crucial they are with less staff. But firefighters are incredibly angry, and morale is very, very low, that despite everything we've done, the cuts just simply keep coming. We've seen, as firefighters, a real-term pay cut of £3,500 per year, and it's tax, like most public sector workers, we're no different. I'm not saying that we are. We've seen our pay attacked, we've seen pay freezes and pay caps, as well as attacks on our pensions. As I say, we're not alone in that, we've all seen that. Now, we recognise that these cuts are government-led, but firefighters are angry, and we're angry that despite everything that we've done in attempting to protect the fire and rescue service in Merseyside for our communities, as I outlined earlier, that in the midst of the onslaught from government, that the Merseyside Fire Authority have saw fit to attack our conditions of service. Now, Merseyside firefighters see this as an ideological and opportunist attack on them by a fire authority that they've done nothing but seek to assist through these cuts. As firefighters, I'll be frank, we're accusing the Labour-controlled Fire Authority of refusing to honour our nationally agreed conditions of service in relation to rates of overtime pay. We see senior officers informing our members that they will never abide by our nationally agreed conditions of service in relation to rates of overtime pay. Now I say to the authority on that point, pay the agreed rate of pay, get the fire engines that are not available at the moment due to insufficient staff back on the run, and stop taking risks with public safety. In Manchester, it took the tragedy of the death of four children in a fire before the Mayor, Andy Burnham, stepped in and instructed the senior management team to pay the agreed rate of pay to put fire engines back on the run. Now, I simply beseech the fire authority now to follow Andy Burnham's lead and not wait for a tragedy like that to occur in Merseyside. But our firefighters are increasingly angry that the fire authority since 2006 have spent nearly £1 million on what they term resilience contracts. And these are being paid currently at £1,000 a year to mainly non-FBU members for them to sign a contract that says that they will break any strike action by the Fire Brigade Union, no matter what the issue the FBU is taking action over. Now, this is paid yearly, regardless of whether the FBU has taken legally convened strike action or not in that year. And we've only taken, from 2006 to date, limited action over pensions. And yet, those payments have been made. This is an absolute disgrace from a Labour-led authority, paying people to break a trade union. And now I call on the Fire Authority to immediately cease those payments and use the £100,000 a year you'll save to put fire engines on the run and stop your anti-union attacks. The Fire Authority have introduced and imposed unagreed shift systems that do not accord with the nationally agreed conditions of service. They've imposed these shifts despite the FBU registering a dispute on the matter at three locations, with another two, Wallasey and City Centre, to follow. And again, and I make no apology for this, I again call on the Fire Authority to get round the table with the FBU and get this sorted out. The Fire Authority have also imposed new contracts on new entrants, which take them outside the nationally agreed firefighter role maps. The imposition of contract change recently in West Midlands saw FBU members retain a 90% vote in favour of strike action in opposition to the similar contractual change. The chair of the Fire Authority in the West Midlands has now agreed to remove that contractual change. Now, I ask the Fire Authority to consider a quick and clear change of position on all of the things that I've outlined. The architects of those previously ideological, driven and unnecessary confrontational policies have left. The chief fire officer has left to take a job up in Australia. The chair of the Fire Authority has resigned. So there is an opportunity for the Fire Authority to listen to the FBU, listen to what the firefighters are asking, abide by our national conditions of service, and stop the attacks on them. For a Labour-led authority, I don't think that's asking too much. It's what we should expect of them, at the very least. Now, I said earlier that firefighters recognise that the cuts are government-led. But there is a solution. Les touched on it. There is £25 million held in reserves. Now, government has already told local authorities, including fire authorities, to spend their reserves down to 5%. Currently, Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service hold 40% of what is their annual reserve, of their annual budget in reserves. Now, government state that they're not going to give us any more money, the Fire and Rescue Service. because the Fire and Rescue Service is awash with money, because they said they've been in touch with all the fire authorities, and there's £600 million held in reserves. We're making their case for them. Government will never look at the funding while those reserves are there. We need to spend those reserves now, as it would be little consultation to a bereaved family or a business that's lost everything to say, well, we're sorry about that, but we've got loads of reserves for a rainy day. We're simply here today asking for your help. Firefighters put themselves on the line and do everything possible to protect you every single day of their working lives. And we're asking you now to help us. We're asking you to speak to your MPs, your councillors, email the chair of the fire authority, join us in leafleting campaigns and town centre demonstrations, and sign and circulate our petitions. We've put the leaflets on the end of the desks with some petitions. We've got thousands for you. If you want to assist, run a campaign, please get in touch with me. We've got thousands printed up for you. Now, we've simply got to convince the 18 members of the fire authority that they're in charge, that they're the guardians of public safety, not the chief fire officers. They have to change tact, reverse the cuts, stop the proposed cuts, and help us to protect the firefighters and protect the public, because now is the hour of their need. Thank you.